The state of Tennessee, CNN can project that Marsha Blackburn will be the first female senator to represent the state of Tennessee.
Joining me now is Senator Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Senator Blackburn, you are the first female U.S. senator from your state in light of Women's History Month this month and International Women's Day. First, I wanted to go into why did you decide to run?
I decided to run because I'm one of those individuals living my life, working in the private sector, involved in the political process, but had never run for office. And I kept saying, we need to do something about the way small business is treated and insurance and taxes and da-da-da. And there was a state Senate position that opened up and people said, why don't you run? And I was trying to help recruit that candidate to run for state Senate. So I did. And then I served in the U.S. House for 16 years. And now, the first woman from Tennessee to hold the U.S. Senate seat.
We still have several states that have never had their first female senator. Why do you think it took Tennessee so long?
I think there are a couple of reasons that conservative women don't step up and run. Number one, it's more difficult because the opportunities in the South seem to go to the next guy in line. And we see this repeatedly. And of course, we know that when you talk to voters, they feel like they most identify with who? A conservative female. What we need to do is make more opportunities for women to get into the process, to serve on boards and commissions, and to serve at the local level and the state level and move on to the federal level.
What kind of words of advice would you give a woman that's wanting to run for U.S. Senate, and maybe especially for a woman that's wanting to run in a state where there is yet to be a female U.S. senator?
What they have to realize is it's up to you to make your own opportunities. And many times you have to step up and just say, I will volunteer to do this or that, or something that is going to help open a door for you. And take advantage of every one of those opportunities because they're not always going to be given to you. Sometimes you have to make that opportunity for yourself. And there are plenty of times throughout my career in both the private sector and the public sector where I felt like I had to overperform, I had to create an opportunity for myself. And sometimes women, I think we as women take it personally when people underestimate us. But actually, I've always kind of seen that as a strength because what frustrates people about elected officials is they will overpromise and underdeliver. So I've thought if they're going to underestimate me, then I will work hard and they will be pleasantly surprised. But that's how you win them over.
Do you think that women tend to be more criticized over their wrongdoings or their, you know, mistakes that they've made in politics than men?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, women are more criticized. And it is so unfortunate that in this day and time, we still have some men who will criticize women for the clothes they wear, for their hair, for the way they sit or stand or walk, and things that have nothing to do with that individual's ability to do her job. And I find that very unfortunate. And there are times where I have heard a man speak disparagingly or inappropriately or has tried to diminish a female colleague. And I've stepped up and said, you're a better man than that. You ought not to say that. That's wrong.
Do you think that there's kind of a difference in how media approaches what women wear versus what men wear?
Media many times will be very critical. And it's unfortunate that in 2020, the year we're going to celebrate 100 years of suffrage for women and celebrate that 19th Amendment, that we still have a media who will many times tout themselves as being so open-minded, but yet they will be so critical, especially of conservative women. Sometimes I say conservative women are really the fourth-class citizens when it comes to life here on Capitol Hill. And many times they don't even want to talk to a conservative woman unless they think they can ridicule her.
So how do you think that we can change this narrative with the media?
One of the things that we can do is just continue to build our own networks, to reach out to people. When they criticize us, call them out or ignore it, whichever is going to be the appropriate way to respond. And another thing that we do is continue to win, to excel, and not let this stop us. I am here for a purpose every single day. I am here to preserve faith, family, freedom, hope, and opportunity. And whatever a celebrity or the media says about me, it's not going to change my commitment to get things done.
So in light of Women's History Month, International Women's Day, do you have a female role model that you have looked up to, even if that's political or not, that's kind of enhanced or inspired your path in life?
Oh, of course, I have plenty of them. And people that have done such great things, and you know, we can look at conservative women throughout our nation's history. You can look in the Bible and find women that really saved the nation of Israel when it was tossed to them to do that job, Deborah and Esther and Huldah. And you can also look at people like Margaret Thatcher and know what she has done. But what does inspire me tremendously every single day is the conservative women that I've served with throughout my career, and they're serving on county commissions and city councils and state legislatures, and they're fighting every single day to break a barrier and to push back barriers that keep women from entering the political process. And that is really an inspiration to me.
Thank you so much, Senator Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee. Thank you for joining us
today. Thank you.